So I will speak about prayer, and the question is how prayer may be fruitful in our life. Alors, perhaps the question is not very good because it may be sometimes a temptation for us when we do not see fruits to discourage. But sometimes fruits are not coming immediately, it takes time. There is a secret work of God. So it's important not to discourage, even if our prayer sometimes not seems to be very efficient, I would say. It's not a question of efficiency, it's a question to welcome God's presence and to let God do what he wants to do. But I would begin with an observation of Saint John of the Cross, this great man, priest, Carmelite, living in the 16th century. In one of his books, he says something a bit strange. He says that there are many people convinced to pray well that pray bad. But on the contrary, there are many people who are convinced to have a very bad prayer, but they pray very well. So it's interesting. So we have to ask this question, where is the difference? What makes a prayer to be good, if we can say, and a prayer to be bad? I think the answer to this question is not so complicated, thanks be to God. And this I would like to develop with you. So the first thing important I spoke about before is to persevere, to be faithful, day after day, week after week, years after year. And not to discourage, but to be faithful to prayer. This is the first quality, I would say, of prayer. The second observation I will speak more about is prayer is good, is genuine, when it is an act of faith, an act of hope, and an act of love. We can pray in many different ways. I can speak to God, I can say my rosary, I can meditate, ponder the gospel, I can just adore the Blessed Sacrament in silence, I can open my heart to God and to sing psalms. So there are so many ways to pray. I don't want to give a technique, but I say what we have to be attentive to is this, and not the external form of prayer, but the inner attitude I have in my heart. And so prayer is good when my way of praying express an act of faith, an act of trust in God, of hope, and an act of love too. So I will explain what I mean. Donc first of all, the prayer has an act of faith. Well, it is clear that as soon as a person is beginning to pray, there is an act of faith. If I pray, I believe. God is existing. I believe God is good. I believe it is good to spend the time with him. So there is an implicit act of faith I do when I am praying. And it is important to understand how, even if this act of faith may be very simple in my heart, it is very important because it is precisely a faith that puts me in contact with the mystery of God. Even if I don't see, even if I don't feel, when I believe, I am in contact with the mystery of God. And God can work in the secret of my heart. Sometimes I can perceive it, sometimes not, but no matter. As soon as I am in an attitude of faith, I am in contact with God's presence and mystery, and allow God to work in the depths of my life. Sometimes, in prayer, we use our human faculties, and this is very good. I use my intelligence, my sensitivity, and sometimes I can be in contact with the Lord through this. For instance, sometimes in prayers, I can have very beautiful feeling. I feel God's presence, I feel God's tenderness, I feel God's love, and this is good because God is not anymore an abstract reality, just an idea, but God becomes, in a certain sense, closer to me when I can feel His presence. But we know very well that in our daily prayer lives, and sometimes we feel beautiful emotions, but sometimes we are very dry. I do not feel anything. I would like, we like to feel, to have good emotion, sweet feelings, but sometimes we have, but very often we don't have. My prayer may be very dry. I feel to be like a stone or a piece of wood without beautiful feelings. But I don't have to discourage, because feeling may be encouraging, may be a help, but it's not the foundation, it's not the basis. The basis is faith. As soon as I believe, I am in contact with God. So I cannot measure the proximity with God with the thermometer of feeling, of emotion. It would be very superficial. If God is giving me sweet emotions, thanks be to God, but when I am dry, I do not feel nothing, I don't have to worry, I just have to believe. And through this act of faith, I am sure to be in contact with God's mystery, and God is capable to work in the depths of my heart. And later, I will see some fruits. Same thing regarding intelligence, intellect, mind. Sometimes in prayer, it's beautiful for us because we can receive some lights, some understanding about God's mystery, about Eucharist, I don't know what. Or sometimes also, through prayer, I can receive some lights for my decision to take, for my daily human life. I ask God a light and the Holy Spirit, and I receive a light, so I can take a good decision. But we know very well that it's very positive, encouraging for us to receive light, understanding through prayer, but sometimes it does not happen. Sometimes I may be dry, as I said, but also I may be in a certain darkness. I don't understand everything. Why this situation, why this trial, which will be my future. So sometimes, in spite of my good will, my desire to be close to God, my intellect is not always full of light, of understanding everything. There is a part of darkness in which I can be sometimes. And there too, I don't have to discourage. My closeness to God is not measured by the intensity, abundance of light I receive in my intellect, but what is important, again, it is faith. Even in darkness, even when I do not understand everything in my life, I can be close to God simply out of my faith. So sometimes we can be in this situation, oh Lord, I do not feel nothing, I do not see nothing, I do not understand nothing, but I believe. I believe in you. A simple act of faith. And I have to be convinced that if this act, this decision of faith is sincere, it puts me in contact with God's mystery. In a hidden way, secret way, but real way, and God is capable to work inside my heart when I am in this attitude of faith. So first point, the foundation so for prayer life is faith, is to believe, and to persevere in believing in God in this way. It's beautiful because faith makes me free, free to receive consolation, to understand a lot of things, but also free to go ahead when I am in dryness or I am in a sort of obscurity. I don't have to discourage. I just have to continue in this attitude of faith, and God will do what He wants to do in my life. The second aspect, I hope to be clear. Yes? Second aspect, so prayer to be good, to be Christian prayer, has to be also an act of hope. But it's clear that as soon as I am praying, there is an attitude of hope. When I pray, I rely upon God. I expect something from God, His grace, His help, the kingdom He will give me after death. So as soon as somebody is praying in a sincere way, there is an attitude of hope, expecting from God what I need to love Him, to follow Him, to live my Christian life. And this act of hope, relying upon God's mercy, is also very simple, but it's very important too. Very important, and for many reasons, but perhaps what I would insist a little on, this act of hope, this attitude of hope in prayer is very important because sometimes in prayer we can experience some poverty. Just I spoke a little about before, but I will speak a little more. And this is normal. Prayer is very paradoxical because sometimes in prayer you can feel a great happiness, a fulfillment. You can see a happiness that nobody can give you on earth, a fulfillment of your expectation, very beautiful and above all human expectation. Sometimes in prayer you can touch heaven, but not every day. Not every day. Because there are also moments, and this is normal, and we don't have to discourage, and sometimes in prayer we have a certain experience of poverty, experience to be poor and very poor. Alors, for different reasons. The first one is because in prayer there is no technique who works always. In daily life you have some techniques. I know how to drive my bicycle, I know how to use my computer, and so I can get what I want to get using this technique. I can master little by little. But prayer is not a technique I can master. I can do a lot of things in prayer, but to master prayer life is not possible because God is God. And we cannot possess God. We depend on Him. And there is no technique so that prayer is always fantastic. It does not exist. Even if I have a good will, even if I do a lot of things to pray well, sometimes my prayer will be fantastic, but sometimes my prayer will be very poor. Don't feel nothing, don't see nothing, as I just said. So there is an experience of poverty because there is no technique to master. We cannot control the relationship with God because God is God. Well, God is good and faithful, but we cannot manipulate God, I would say. And also, second reality, which is important to understand, it is that the more I am close to God, the more I will see my poverty, my limitation, my sin, what is not my wounds, what in me is complicated, is wounded, is far from living the gospel, the part of poverty, of sin, of human fragility that there is in me. I can see it more and more clearly. This also, prayer is paradoxical because sometimes when I pray, God is consoling me, encouraging me, so it may be very sweet to pray, but sometimes prayer means also enter, be closer to God, and so it means enter more deeply in God's light, in God's truth. And the light of God may be sometimes very consoling, very sweet, but sometimes the light with which God is illuminating our life may be difficult, may be painful sometimes, because this light shows me my littleness, my poverty, my sin. And I would give an example. If you have a house in summer, there is a bright sun outside and the house is completely closed. There is just a small hole, and through the hole there is a beam of sun entering the house. And in this very intense light of the beam of sun, you see dust, a lot of dust. And you say, but I could not imagine there was so much dust in this room. But in the very intense beam of light coming from the hall, you can see all the dust there is in the room. And so it is the same for us. Sometimes the light of God, when we are closer to Him, is showing all the dust there is inside. Our sin, our wounds, our comprimation with the spirit of the world, our hidden pride, our hardness of heart. So sometimes it may be painful. It's not very sweet for our pride to experience, to be poor, facing God's light. I am a poor man, I am a sinner. I am not better than my father, as says the prophet Elijah at the time. I see my misery, my poverty. This is not comfortable, but we have to accept it. I just want to give an example. Suppose here in St. Patrick, there is perpetual adoration of the Blessed Sacrament. This is great. And suppose a lady on Sunday, she signed up for 1 hour of adoration on Friday night between 11 and midnight. And the lady, Catholic lady, is very happy to sign up for adoration. I will have a very sweet hour with Jesus, my beloved. So she's very happy to sign up for having 1 hour of adoration. But Friday night is arriving, and the lady goes to adoration, to Eastern, but she's very tired this day. She has difficulty to concentrate. She has many distractions. She's looking at the watch every 5 minutes because time seems to be very, very long. And also, 2 hours before going to adoration, she had a struggle with her husband or a teenager in the family, and she's boiling of anger against because of this discussion she had. And so that means instead of having 1 hour of a sweet mystical experience, it becomes a very difficult hour because I have my anger, I am tired, I cannot pray, and everything that is wrong in my life is showing up. My regret for the past, my fear for the future, my difficulty to live the present moment, all that is not good in my life is showing up like a big cloud, I don't know what. So this hour of adoration is not to be in paradise, but it is a difficult time because all the problems in my life, I am facing these problems. And so here, hope becomes important. Here, hope becomes salvation. And what is to hope in this context is to say, oh Lord Jesus, I am so poor in this time of prayer, of silence, and I cannot escape because I have to stay. I am the only one. I cannot escape. But in this time of adoration, I feel to be so poor, so little, so miserable, so wounded. But no matter. No matter because I hope in you, Jesus. I don't hope in me. I don't pretend to save myself, to save me by myself. My hope is in you, O Lord. I feel to be poor, I feel to be miserable, but no problem, because I trust you. You are my Savior. You are my forgiveness. You are the one who will heal me and save me and help me. And so it is an opportunity, and when we feel to be poor, it's a very beautiful grace, because it's a big opportunity to rely on God and not anymore on myself, to hope in God and not anymore in my personal successes in spiritual or human life. It is said in the life of the King Saint Louis, the Holy King of France in the Middle Age, that Jesus told him one day, you would like pray like a saint, but I invite you to pray like a poor. You would like to pray like a saint, but I invite you to pray like a poor man. And what is beautiful, it is that in the Bible, so many times, it is said that the prayer who touches God, the prayer who goes to heaven, is the prayer of the poor. In different Psalms, you have this beautiful invitation and not to discourage. God listened to the prayer of the poor. A poor man cried out, God came to save him from his anxiety and so on. So this is a constant message in the Holy Scripture that God takes care of the poor. God listened to the prayer of the poor and come to console, to help, to visit him when this poor person trusts, hope completely in God. And the more I feel to be poor, the more I hope in God. I have no other solution. And so it's good to be poor, because it's an opportunity for us to hope, to trust God, to believe in God, to rely on God, and not anymore on my being better than other people. And there is also a very clear example of this reality I'm speaking on in the Gospel of Luke, the parable of the Pharisee and the tax collector. Two men were going to the temple to pray, and there was a Pharisee praying like that, "Oh Lord, I thank you because I am not like the sinners. Thank you, I am not like other people, especially the tax collector is despising. I fast 2 days a week, I give my tithes on everything." The man very happy with himself. Well, this is a prayer of the Pharisee, and there is the prayer of the tax collector. He does not dare to go forward. He remains backward, not lifting up the eyes, but eyes down and beating his chest and saying, "Oh Lord, have mercy on me. I am a sinner. Have mercy on me, O Lord." And what says Jesus? This man was justified. The Pharisee, when he went back home, he was exactly the same. Before and after, the same. But the tax collector, after, he was justified, he was forgiven, he was changed by God's grace, because his prayer was a prayer of truth, a prayer of humility, a prayer of confidence in God's mercy. Have mercy on me, O Lord Jesus. And sometimes our prayer can be a prayer of thanksgiving, of exaltation, but sometimes our prayer will be the prayer of the poor. Have mercy on me, O Lord. I am so sinner, so weak, so miserable. I feel it, I see it. And sometimes in spiritual life, we have the feeling not to go forward, but the feeling to go backward. But we do not go backward. Just we see more clearly what we are. And this is a good step, because it is a step toward humility, toward hope, toward relying on God and not on myself. So sometimes in a prayer, I don't say every day, but perhaps often anyway, our prayer, we have to accept our prayer to be the prayer of the poor, without feelings, without a beautiful light, mystical light, without also being very happy to be who I am, but the prayer of the poor. And what is beautiful is that the prayer of the poor, if we accept this poverty, if we hope in God, if we entrust everything to God, we will find peace. As if God was telling us, "Yes, you are very poor, but I love you. You are my son, you are my daughter. You are poor, you are miserable, you are sinner, but I love you. I gave my life for you. I am here to console you. I am here to save you. I am here to forgive you. I am here to heal you." So don't be afraid with your poverty. Don't be afraid to be poor and to have a very poor prayer sometimes. And just hope in God and trust God and persevere. And God will console and heal and transform little by little your heart and give you a new heart according to the promise of the scripture. I will give you a new spirit, a new heart. But to receive the grace of inner transformation, I have to be poor in spirit. Blessed are the poor in spirit. So we don't have to be afraid when our prayer life is poor. It's okay. I just have to not to discourage, to accept it and to trust God. And as I just said, as the more I feel to be poor, the more I have to trust, the more I have to hope. The more I have to hope and not to listen to the devil who try to discourage and to accuse me. I just have to trust God, to believe in Him, to offer everything to Him and to persevere with God. And God will transform my poverty, my misery in grace, in abundance of life and blessing and wisdom and grace. And God is so powerful. And sometimes we think that God is capable to do good things only through our better part. But God is capable to do great things also with our poverty, our misery. And God is manifesting His power through weakness, says Saint Paul. So we just have to accept to be poor and weak, but to rely completely on God, to jump in God's hands, so to that I am not the one who control and lead everything, but I am the one who completely is given to God, belongs to God, and let God do what He wants to do, and not what I want God to do. So, kind of abandonment of putting oneself completely in God's merciful hands, and we will see how God is good, how God is pitiful, how God is faithful and capable to use my poverty to enrich me with His grace and His presence. It's a beautiful mystery. How God is capable to transform human poverty in grace if we accept it and if we hope in Him. And the more I could have reasons to lose hope, the more I hope, I decide for hope. Hoping against any hope, says Paul, speaking about Abraham. Hope is so important. Expecting everything from God with confidence. Whatever may be my external difficulties, my problems, whatever may be my inner poverty, no matter, I hope in God, I trust Him. I rely completely on God's mercy and God's faithfulness, and I will experience it, that God is good and faithful and tender as a good Father He is. So this was the second point. First one, prayer has to be an act of faith. Prayer has also to be an act of hope. An act of humility, acknowledging what I am, and an act of hope, just because God is God. Just because God wants me to trust in Him. And it's not so easy for us because we would like always to rely on ourselves. And we have difficulty to rely only upon God. There is. But it takes time, but it is a good way to go, to accept to be poor and to rely more and more on God's faithfulness and mercy. So the third, The third theological virtue practice in prayer, I spoke about faith, hope. Now we speak a little about love. So this is very important too. Prayer will be a good prayer, transforming little by little. It takes time, we have to be patient. But prayer will be also a transforming prayer if it is an act of love. An act of love, that is, when I pray, I don't pray for my satisfaction, but I want to love God. I want to belong to God. You are my Lord. You are the master of my life. I want to obey you. I want to follow you. I want to do your will. I want to belong to you completely. I want to love you, O Lord. Even if I feel to be poor and wounded, no matter. I want to love you with all my heart. As it is said in the Bible, not only 90%, but I want to love you with all my heart, O Lord. And so in prayer life, if in prayer life there is this intention to belong to God, to give oneself to God, to love God completely, so prayer will be good. Because prayer is a mystery of love. And I would say so that prayer is an act of love for God, is giving time to God, and this is very precious. Time is very precious, so giving time to God is an act of love, very authentic and very beautiful. But I would say also that it seems beautiful for us to understand that any prayer is also not only an act of love for God, but also an act of love for our neighbors, our brothers and sisters, for different reasons. The first reason is that if I pray, so if I search God, if I am attracted by God, many other people will too be attracted by God. There is a beautiful meditation about this in the Little Thérèse of Lisieux. She understood that the more I am attracted by God, the more all the people I am linked with also will be attracted to God. This is a mystery of the communion of the saints. So nobody is alone in prayer. When somebody is praying, it is for so many people, even if I don't think to them. Every time I am closer to God, I am attracting other people behind me. I don't see, I don't feel, but it is the truth. And one day I will see that many people came closer to God because I had the courage to search God and to be faithful to prayer. I would say also that prayer is an act of charity toward my brothers and sisters because little by little, prayer is transforming me. I am more humble. I am more compassionate. I am more merciful because I experience God's mercy. Little by little, being in contact with God and experiencing God's patience and mercy and tenderness makes me imitating God. Well, it takes time, but little by little. So a person who is faithful to prayer is more attentive to other people, more compassionate, more open, more capable to love because my heart is little by little filled by the love of God. A few years ago, I was giving a retreat in USA in a big charismatic parish in Ann Arbor. And it was a retreat for women. There were 450 women for the retreat. It was a big retreat. And 2 days after, I received a phone call from a man. Oh, Father Jacques, I want to thank you. I am a husband of a lady who came to your retreat. I don't know what you have done to her, but she's so calm, so tender, so attentive. I have never seen her like that. It is God's work, only. But blessed is the man whose spouse is a woman of prayer, and blessed is the woman whose husband is a man who prays. Because prayer, I don't say we become saint in 2 days. It takes so many years. But I say that little by little, prayer makes us more humble, more peaceful, more attentive, more compassionate. This is an act of charity. When I am angry, instead of taking the people who are making me angry, it's better to go to the here in front of the Blessed Sacrament and to spend 1 hour with Jesus, so the anger, little by little, may go far. And sometimes it's a duty for us to pray until my heart again finds some quiet and peace and love for the people God has given to me to live with. And also the third reason for which prayer is an act of charity for our brothers and sisters. It is when prayer is prayer of intercession, when we pray for them. Alors, prayer must not be only intercession. It must be also contemplation, praise, thanksgiving, adoration. But there is also a part of our prayer life who can be intercession. I pray for the conversion of these people, of this member of my family. And this is also a beautiful act of charity. Okay? And sometimes it may be a consolation for us. Because prayer is not only a duty, it's also a consolation, because sometimes we want to help somebody and we are powerlessness. This is a great challenge in life, a great suffering. I want to help somebody. For instance, I am a parent and I have some son or daughter who is doing very bad, doing crazy things. It may be a suffering. This boy or girl, I could help him or her when it was a baby, but now he or she is 20 years old, listen everybody except parents, so I am powerless to help this person I love so much, who is in danger, and I cannot help this person, but I can pray. I can pray, I can hope, I can love in prayer, I can entrust everything to God. And this is a consolation. And when we are powerlessness facing certain situation, to know that I can entrust everything to God in an efficient way. I don't know where, I don't know when God will act, but I know God will do something. The gospel says that when you ask somebody to God, he will listen to you. So it's a big consolation for us in some situation in which we cannot help anybody anymore. To know that prayer, through prayer I can reach the suffering. I can be close to everyone through prayer. It's a great consolation. So, prayer is an act of love for God. It's also an act of love for our brothers and sisters. For me too, because prayer is helping me to grow in the most beautiful way. I would, in my conclusion, add an important observation. So I just spoke about prayer as authentic prayer being an act of love for God. I belong to you. I want to serve you. To love you as much as possible, oh my Lord. This is beautiful. But there is something we don't have to forget. Something said in the first reading we had at the Mass, that for relating to the relationship between man and God, love between man and God, we don't have to forget a very important reality. And this is the important reality, that the one who first is loving is God. We were not the first to love God, but God, the first one, loved us and gave his son Jesus in expiation for our sins. It was in the reading this morning. And God is always the first one to love. What is important is always the initiative of God. Our answer is very important too, but we don't have to forget that the first one to love is God. He is the source of any love. So there is a consequence which is important in prayer life. It is that what is important in prayer is to love God, to give me myself to God. But what is more important yet is to welcome God's love, to receive God's love, to believe in God's love. And perhaps this is almost the deepest aspect of prayer life, to be facing God as a poor, but a poor who is happy to receive, to welcome God's presence and God's love. La prayer is above all not doing this or saying that. Prayer above all is welcoming a presence. Welcoming a loving presence. Welcoming a love. Alors, perhaps I don't feel it, I don't see it, but I believe in it. No matter if I don't believe, if I don't see, don't feel, but sometimes God gives us the grace to feel His love, and it is great. But even when I am poor, even when I do not feel nothing, I have to believe in the love God has for me. So prayer is, this is a very essential dimension of prayer, to be in God's presence, in faith, welcoming, receiving God's infinite mercy and love for me. I trust in your love, O Lord. I believe in your love. I am a poor little person, but I believe so much in your love. This is my riches. And not what I do, what I succeed, what I fulfill, but my riches is what I receive from you. You're pure and deep and merciful and so tender and so precious love. I am here not to achieve something. It's not a job I have to succeed. I am here to welcome you, to receive your presence, your loving presence. Facing me, I would say. It's not so easy, because it's supposed that the center is not me anymore, but God is the center. I am not the one who prays. I am the one who receives. But this is so important and so beautiful, because the more we are in this attitude, the more God will come and bless us. And we have also to be realistic that the love with which I can respond to God, the love with which I can love my brothers and sisters, I have to receive it before. I have to welcome it from God. He is the source of any kind of love. So this is a very simple aspect of prayer, very simple but so important. God, I trust your love, I receive, I welcome, I believe in your love. I just want to receive him and to give you the permission to love me as much as you want to love me. And sometimes we don't do it because we are too attentive to ourselves. We think not to be worthy. We think we have to deserve to merit God's love. Don't have to merit God's love. We have to welcome God's love. It is free of cost. And to illustrate this attitude of welcoming in confidence and God's love given to me in a free way, given to me because God is love, not because I deserve it, not because I am better than other people, not because I have working so much, not just because God is love. And wants to love me. The greatest desire of God is to love us and to have us accepting His love, simply, without discussing or thinking, I am worthy or not. Nobody is worthy, but God is infinitely merciful. And just to welcome God's love and to be thankful. Thank you for your infinite love you are giving to me. I believe in it. Perhaps I don't, sometimes I feel it, but sometimes I don't feel nothing, no matter, I believe. This sentence above the picture of the family of Bethany. Jesus loved Martha and Maria. Jesus loves you, brothers and sisters. Each one of you, with an infinite love, incredibly pure and respectful. And God just can just propose, cannot impose. Do you want me to love you? Do you want me to love you? And somebody said, no, wait time, when I will be more pretty, more I don't know what. more strong. You will, I will give you the permission to love me. And this we do so often. And God is asking, do you want me to love you now, as you are? Poor, wounded, sinner. Do you want me to love you? Just to give my love. And God is so happy with that. And sometimes we don't do it because we don't believe, we don't trust in God's love. We have many things. And just to conclude with a testimony of little Thérèse of Lisieux. She speaks in the story of the soul about some difficulty she had in prayer. She had a prayer usually very dry. She did not feel, for some exception, but usually her prayer was very dry, but she accepted it. I have faith, it's enough, I believe. So I don't worry, and not to feel, not to understand a lot of things. And also, she had another problem in prayer life, that sometimes, and often, probably, she says, she was falling asleep. Because she was very young, when she entered Carmel, she was a teenager, the night was short, the day very busy, so during the prayer time, she had 2 hours at least of silent prayer every day. And during this time of prayer and thanksgiving after communion, there was also a silent prayer there, she was falling asleep. And so she could have been discouraged with that. And she said no. So I just want to read Thérèse. I should be desolate for having slept for 7 years during my hours of prayer and my thanksgiving after Holy Communion. Well, I am not desolate. And she gives 3 reasons why she accepts this poverty, to not to be capable to stay, but to sleep. I remember that little children are as pleasing to their parents when they are asleep as well when they are wide awake. I remember too that when they perform operations, doctors put their patients to sleep. Finally, I remember that the Lord knows our weakness, is mindful that we are but dust and ashes. So I can explain everything, but just the first reason she gives. She is not discouraged to sleep sometimes during prayer because she knows that God is looking to her with love. Parents, little children are as pleasing to their parents when they are asleep as well when they are wide awake. So it's very beautiful. There is a bit of humor in this, but there is also a beautiful spiritual truth. Thérèse understood that what is important in prayer is not what I do, but what God does. This is important. And I spoke with somebody, say, perhaps you are distracted during prayer, but God is not distracted. And God is loving you the same. And God is loving you. He's looking at you with love and communicating in a secret sometimes, but real way. God is communicating to you His love. And when you stay in prayer, Lord, when you are awake, it's great. But even if sometimes you sleep, it's not a big problem. Because God is loving you the same and giving you His presence, His love, His mercy. God is happy to love you. Just God is not only the one who accepts you. No, God is the one who loves you. He's happy to love you. And you have to be happy to welcome His love. If you want to make God happy, you have to say, Lord, I thank you so much because you love me as I am, with an infinite love and mercy. I'm happy to receive your love. And that is not so easy for us because we are very much self-centered. And this means not to be self-centered, but to be God-centered. What is important is not me, what I do. I have made a beautiful prayer, I'm very happy with that. But what is important is God with loving me and me welcoming God's love and responding to this love according to my possibility today. And the more I welcome God's love, the more I will be capable to love him in return and to love my brothers and sisters. So I will finish now. So ask this grace to the Lord that when we pray, whatever prayer we use, it may be an act of sincere faith, confidence, an act of hope, and also giving myself to God, but above all, welcoming with confidence and gratitude, welcoming God's love for me, accepting God's love and being thankful to be so much loved, and that this love, the more I welcome it, the more, little by little, it will transform my heart. And we have to be little children facing God and welcoming his tenderness, his pity, his mercy, his presence, his love. And giving God the permission to love us infinitely as he wants to love us. We thank you, Lord, for your infinite love. Thank you for your look upon you, a look of tenderness, of joy, to look at us because we are your children and you are our God. And you decided to be our Father and to bless us and to love us infinitely. And we want to thank you and to welcome more and more your love, to be capable to share it with other people in our life. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.